Respected Deputy Chairman, sir, I am new to this house and I can well describe myself as a junior student of the international politics as a subject. Perhaps I may not be delivering a lengthy speech like the previous speaker, because I believe in the beauty of brevity, but at the same time I would like to be a little more serious, because I was hoping that the speakers, and especially from our honorable opposition benches, would be extremely serious while sharing their ideas, sharing their assessment, sharing their thoughts about India's external affairs. I was hoping that the discourse will be taken beyond rhetoric. I was hoping that observations will not be, allegations will not be made under the garb of observations. I was hoping that there won't be a trivialization. When you seek a short duration discussion, I was literally meaning that it will be a short duration discussion. I was not knowing that somebody will change the agenda or the time schedule, but then it is the sweet will of the House, and the chair also has accepted. We certainly don't mind. We are very democratic for that matter. But then, I was not expecting that immediately after taking over, few months thereafter, the Prime Minister declared that we will give a facility, and that is of the self-attestation to the people of India. You can attest your own certificates. That was very remarkable, and it's a very important reform. Although, for our day-to-day lives, things become very easier with this kind of a reform. But I was not knowing that self-attestation will be taken as self-certification. When our honorable member said that we are a very responsible opposition, I was expecting that perhaps the certificate should come from this side and not from that side itself. But then, if we really take a look, and a serious look, if I may say so, to the 3 years of handling of foreign affairs by the current NDA government, I cannot but recall when the Prime Minister took over the reins in 2014. More than 3 years before, sir, when the Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, took over, the reaction of the world was full of curiosity and a reasonable amount of surprise as well. But the level of astonishment of the foreign policy watchers world over reached a new high when the Prime Minister decided to invite all the heads of the neighboring countries as special guests to his swearing-in ceremony, which was a very important gesture and which was welcomed by one and all. Looking back, I believe the Narendra Modi government has restored a robust sense of purpose, a sense of authenticity, a sense of ownership, and above all, a very deep sense of mutuality to our foreign policy. And I'll explain how this has happened one by one. When I talk about a robust sense of purpose, right from his invite to the South Asian country heads to his latest visit to Israel, there is some game plan. It was asked, what is your roadmap? I mean, the roadmap is very evident, and it has been described by many experts in foreign policy that foreign policy has to be a little silent as well. But I believe there are many things which have come to the fore, and people who are genuinely wanting to understand our foreign policy, they are able, not only able to understand our foreign policy, but they are in fact welcoming the changes that we are introducing. And therefore, right from the first involvement or the invitation to the South Asian country heads to the visit to Israel, every step was taken, Mr. Deputy Chairman, sir, with a particular objective. A master planner and an artful implementer, what I would describe Prime Minister Modi, he has taken India's diplomatic ties far ahead of exchange of pleasantries and sharing of goodwill. He has, in every visit undertaken by him, either further fortified the foundations of bilateral ties or built a strong edifice of mutuality. Few years back, and I recall, when he had been to Japan, apart from other functions of diplomatic importance, remember, the Prime Minister made it a point to meet with the Japanese scientist who has done great research in prevention of a very devastating ailment which we know as sickle cell anemia. And therefore, there is a sense of purpose behind every other move, behind every other tour that he has undertaken. It is very sad that some people from the other parties described his foreign travels in different ways, and they in fact decided to ridicule him for no reason whatsoever. I mean, this is trivialization. There was a reference that we are not going to trivialize. Then what were you doing when you were ridiculing, when you were kind of calling names to the Prime Minister? Somebody said that, oh, the Prime Minister is now on visit to India. Is that the way we treat our head of the government? This was utterly irresponsible, but we tolerated. And therefore, I would like the entire opposition also and all people in our country to look at the changes, look at the kind of reforms that we have introduced in our foreign policy regime in a more serious manner. Many politicians, as I said, irresponsibly criticize the Prime Minister on his foreign tours. But they must understand that the very relationship, even international relationship, is a matter of cultivation. You cannot just expect that within a day or two it can happen. It has to have a deep involvement, a deep engagement, and therefore, as I said, it's a matter of cultivation. Such criticism, as I said, is churlish. Prime Minister Modi ji's engagements abroad are in fact anchored in the recognition that India's domestic success, and I must underscore this, India's domestic success is inextricably linked to how it can shape its external environment to national advantage. Sir, it was not for no reason that India was always ridiculed world over. People said it's a Hindu rate of growth and things like that. Even today, people say, oh, it's a country of snake charmers and cattle on the streets. There has to be a resolve to come out of this perception. And what Prime Minister Modi has very resolutely attempted at and successfully achieved is the change in perception about India. The world doesn't look at India the way it was looking at India a couple of years before. And we must appreciate this, arising above partisan politics. We must appreciate this, sir. If I have to just enlist what all contributions have been made by Prime Minister Modi, he has redoubled investment in protecting Indian interests in the larger Indian Ocean region. I was hoping that there will be some reference to that, but unfortunately, there was nothing. His remarkable outreach to the United States, despite past personal irritants, and we know. His intensification of the emerging partnership with Japan, an important player in international politics. His success in preserving balanced ties with both China and Russia, and his nurturing of important partners in Western Europe, Central and Southeast Asia, and in the Persian Gulf, where he demonstrated a geopolitical adroitness unusual in Indian foreign policy, sir. All this has been complemented by an unanticipated investment in building personal ties with President Trump, Prime Minister Netanyahu, or Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, or closer home, Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina. Sir, I had the privilege of visiting Bangladesh some 7-8 months before as a part of a party delegation. And we had a very wonderful dialogue with Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina. And she was crediting the Prime Minister of India for having done away with several issues which were kind of obstacles in harmonious relationship with Bangladesh. So that kind of very open endorsement of Modi ji's policy, I think many of us should be learning about, from the kind of appreciation that we received for his policies in Bangladesh. At the same time, sir, I must also point this out here, that from Canada to Fiji, wherever Prime Minister Modi has gone, as recently as in Israel, he engaged with the Indian diaspora in a very systematic, in a very powerful manner. And the harnessing of the strength of Indian diaspora, I believe it's something which is very innovative, very new to the Indian foreign policy, which we must recognize. Now I come to the element of authenticity. Sir, the sense of authenticity with which the Prime Minister and under his leadership, the government of which Our esteemed External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj ji is one of the key members. The honest efforts on the part of the government to evolve ties with Bangladesh, as I mentioned, with Nepal, and even in Pakistan, even with Pakistan, there were references about all kinds of things. But let me tell you, at all, there is a very significant feature of the Indian foreign policy of the present regime. It is that we want harmonious ties with everybody, all neighbors, but on our terms. This is something which is uncompromisingly stated by many of our leaders. We want harmonious relationship, but on our terms, not with some kind of a compromise with Indian interests. And therefore, I think this has restored a sense of authenticity. We have linked very successfully India's foreign policy to our domestic transformation. Again, let me also tell you that when the desire is very powerful, when the design is very clear in everybody's mind, and when there are no doubts about our own intentions in our own minds, I believe we can gather strength to come out of, to overcome the historic hesitations that Indian foreign policy was crippled with. Take the example of Israel. It was not required that a regime change was to have, it was not required that India need to have a regime change to have a very powerful, harmonious, functional relationship with Israel. Gone are the days of hyphenation. There was a reference to that. We believe in our relationship, the strength of our ties with Palestine, beyond doubt. Why should we pit one country against the other? I mean, they themselves are also trying to harmonize their relationship, and we are still in the olden era. Oh, come on, what the Palestine will respond if we develop harmonious relationship with Israel? Let us come out of that, and India has done rightly the same thing. The third thing, and I would like to bring this to the notice of the House, is about the ownership. The Prime Minister and all those in the foreign policy, in the Foreign Affairs Department, they have laid an independent foundation for our relationship, as I said, especially with the NRI community, to invest. I mean, there is now, as I was told, the Foreign Affairs Ministry, the External Affairs Ministry has come out with an independent setup to allow the NRIs who are maybe in US or in UK or wherever, they can invest in that foundation. It's a trust. And that money could be utilized for the well-being, for the development projects in their own villages or towns which they originally belong to. I mean, this is such a brilliant idea, and I am told that huge amounts have already come over there and they are going to be utilized. So sense of ownership, and our NRI community requires that. They want a sense of participation also. Through participation, you get a sense of ownership. Again, the engagement with assertion, if that is the principle with which the government is moving ahead. It's a small thing, perhaps, but remarkably, the Prime Minister has insisted upon the use of Indian languages, Hindi particularly, while dealing with foreign diplomats. It may be sounding as a very small thing, but I think it has a very important meaning as well. And therefore, if the Japanese Prime Minister converses with other dignitaries in Japanese, if the Chinese leaders converse in Chinese, in Mandarin, what had prevented us from using our own languages? And therefore, this also, I believe, is very remarkable, although it may sound as a very small thing. The sense of ownership amongst the Indian diplomatic cadre, again, I give you the example of the transformations that are being introduced in, this is just one example, in our consulate in New York. There was a very brilliant consul general there who is now back in India. But he was, under the instructions of our Honorable External Affairs Minister, he sought a permission to reorganize his own consulate office. And he found out there was a huge amount of treasure, in fact, of important documents and things like that, which is now put on display over there. And these are, again, as I said, very small things. But when you develop a sense of ownership towards the job that our diplomats are doing, things definitely happen in a different way. Again, ownership of our cultural heritage. Sir, when we talk about cultural heritage, we cannot but, and I hope the opposition also will be large-hearted enough, to give complete credit to the Prime Minister for having established the International Yoga Day on the 21st of June. There are not, hundreds of days are observed internationally. Hundreds of days are observed internationally, which are approved by the United Nations. But in the recent past, I believe this is the only day which the proposal for which India mooted.
I am requesting him with respect. I've just said, देखिए झगड़े की बात नहीं है.
ये बोलिए बोलिए.
Sir. 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 Deputy Chair, Vice Chairman, sir. I just want to inform the House, since the Honourable Member has said that this was the only one, on 15th of June 2007, India's resolution, supported by 3/4 of the membership of the United Nations, forced the convening of a special session of the UN General Assembly, in which India's resolution to declare 2nd October, Mahatma Gandhi's birth anniversary, as International Day of Nonviolence, was passed unanimously. Mr. So please don't say it is the first time.
I mean, you should not be having this kind of a sense of one-upmanship, sir. I mean, nobody can deny the contribution of our previous prime ministers. Let us understand that on 15th August, while speaking from the...
Please don't say that.
We have appreciated all our former prime ministers. Our own prime minister, Prime Minister Modi, from the ramparts of the Red Fort on 15th August 2014, has large-heartedly said, and very rightly so, that the contribution of all our previous prime ministers is duly recognized. We are not in quarrel with anybody. But let us also not forget that it took more than 50 years for India to have a particular day established as International Day, which you are talking about, which is 2nd of October. No, it's a fact. It happened in 2007, not before that. And within just 3 years of our coming to power, again, I'm not saying this with a one-upmanship. We are all together here. And I hope you will be taking legitimate sense of pride also when International Yoga Day is established. So please have that sense, sir. With folded hands, I'm requesting you. But then, about this sense of ownership, sir, there was reference to surgical strikes and other things. But let me tell you that nobody can deny the importance in which India retaliated. This was necessary. This was essential. History will certainly give a place of importance to these kinds of measures taken by India. And certainly, it has made Pakistan learn a few lessons beyond doubt. Sir, with the way we have handled our issues in several international forums, including the discussions about Paris Accord. There was a reference here made earlier, and one would be enlightened to listen to how our HRD minister, who was then Minister for Environment, Mr. Prakash Javadekar, handled the situation to our advantage and ensured that the accord is reached. India played an important role. You may deny it simply because of partisan approaches, but yes, Indian leadership played an important role in making Paris Accord happen. And therefore, I must say that India, instead of remaining just a rule taker, has become a rule maker, and this has been universally accepted. Let us understand. The way we invested our strength, the way we took efforts to ensure the establishment of BRICS Bank, for example, or more importantly, the International Solar Alliance. Sir, tell me, when recently in the past there was a kind of international alliance on a subject which is as important as energy? We are talking about energy security and things like that. But it was India which took the lead in establishing the International Solar Alliance, and very successfully, and we have now the secretariat here in Gurgaon. Sir, this is a very, very remarkable success, and let us rise above partisan considerations and applaud this success under the leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Sir, the last point which I wanted to make is about mutuality. A sense of mutuality, after all, international relations can never be lopsided. I mean, we will not allow, we should not allow, and I believe no other country will allow that the advantages are to a particular country and not to both the countries which are engaging in some kind of a mutual relationship, mutual understanding. And therefore, I believe, and I must point this out here, that the bilateral discussions that happened, which are very important in cultivation of foreign policy and external relations. For example, in Nepal, say, India and Nepal, the heads of governments met 17 years after. In so far as Fiji is concerned, it happened 33 years after. In so far as Seychelles is concerned, it happened 34 years after. Insofar as Canada is concerned, it happened 42 years after. And insofar as United Arab Emirates are concerned, it happened 34 years after. I mean, I really wonder, I mean, what exactly we were doing all these years? Why these relationships were not looked after? Why were we hesitant? Or I don't know whether there was an inertia in cultivating these relationships, but unfortunately, it so happened that it was left to Prime Minister Narendra Modi to strengthen these relationships, to take these relationships ahead, which is very important. Sir, about Vietnam also, about Africa also, all these countries were looking forward, and even today they are in the changed situation, they are looking forward to India to provide relationship, and India is doing the same. Sir, when we took over in 2014, the Bharatiya Janata Party manifesto has clearly mentioned that there will be the five pillars of Indian foreign policy when we come to power. And what were those pillars? Those pillars were Samman, mutuality of respect, Suraksha, mutuality of security, Sambad, a dialogue, a very vibrant dialogue, Samruddhi, prosperity for both the countries, for all the countries for that matter, and last but not the least, civilization. Sir, our civilizational ties are extremely important. They are in fact the important cornerstone of our foreign policy regime. It has to be that way. And therefore, sir, let me, before I conclude, mention over here that during the last 3 years, the efforts that we have put in, we have taken the Indian foreign policy way ahead of the olden days of non-alignment. We are now aligned with everybody for that matter, because we are in true spirit of Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas, even in foreign affairs, we are befriending with every other bloc internationally recognized, every other country, and taking everybody ahead with us. We also have brought the Indian foreign policy far more, it has become far more serious than the talk of universal peace and coexistence. These words are important, but the words need to be given some meaning, and through our actions, we have certainly given some meaning to the ideas of universal peace and coexistence. Secondly, India is not just a destination, as I mentioned earlier, just a land of snake charmers where cattle are in the street or there are IT engineers. India has become one of the best attractive destinations for investors world over, and this also is a fact which we certainly cannot be undermining. Sir, insofar as India's foreign policy is concerned, it is a civilizational journey, and we have been taking it from the past through the present to the future towards really achieving a universal, a coexistence and harmony, a world with coexistence and harmony. With this, I conclude my speech, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very good. Professor.